Wow. I like to get undeserved applause. It's rare, but makes me feel good anyway. I've got 30 minutes to do a 1 hour and 20 minute presentation, so I'm gonna go very fast. And as Lindsay Cosgrove knows, I can fill up 3 hours in a second. Get myself organized here. My slides are up, my clicker's going. So I'm gonna give you the conclusion of my presentation, just so we don't miss it. I've done a lot of work with arts education over the years, partly with the Annenberg Challenge, partly with the chair of the Governor's Literacy and the Arts Task Force in Rhode Island, and partly because I've had roots in arts. It was a critical part of my educational experience in New York City. I played the viola in junior high school. The fact that I'm using the term junior high school helps you understand how old I am, because we still had junior high schools. And for much of the time that I've been working with arts educators, they have been engaged in this effort to demonstrate through research that arts can enhance mathematics, science, and literacy. Right? It's like, yeah, right? When in fact, in my educational experience, people engaged in art because of the value of arts in and of itself. Right? It did make contributions, but people weren't trying to spend their time proving that doing the arts is going to advance mathematics and science. Doing the arts is going to enhance you as an individual, as a thinker, as a creator, which will enhance mathematics, science, and literacy. So one of the things I would urge you to do is to stop trying to prove that arts has a value to other disciplines and start demonstrating that arts is a value in and of itself. Right. Second thing I'm going to ask you to do is to recognize, as much as we say as a nation we are engaged in evidence-based reform, we quite frankly are not. We are engaged in reform that's driven by ideology. Right? And you have to understand that ideology only accepts evidence that supports the values and beliefs of a particular stance. Right? If I don't believe in the arts, you can present me with a wealth of data that will not change my mind. Right? Shifting ideology requires mobilization, action, and policy change. And so I would say that, you know, while research is important, sorry, Sarah, all right, it's important in the hands of people who already understand and value the position. And the task for us is to figure out what kind of ideological climate are we in, what's favorable about that climate, what's unfavorable about that climate, and how do we form alliances with people who can shift the ideology in ways that change policy and practice. That, ladies and gentlemen, concludes my presentation. Wow. I got 27 minutes. But what I'm saying is we are now in an ideological environment, or we have been for the last 15 years, that I think is largely unfavorable to the kinds of work that I do. I'm not going to speak for you. My work is grounded in a belief in the importance of culture, and in fact a belief that learning and thinking are not just intellectual cognitive activities, they're culturally organized. Right? I also believe in equity and social justice, and education is designed to serve the concerns about equity, which is about making sure that all of us have the supports we need to inform and thrive in the society, and we all have the ability to create the society and make it our own. And social justice is about identifying where inequities exist and using education and other resources in our society to address them. Now, there are those of us who don't believe that. And for those who don't, then education has a very different kind of lens. So I want to talk about historically the kind of ideological environment we're in, how we got here, and how we need to create a smart education system in many of our communities to change the national discourse and to change the results that that we see. And understanding that we are now at an ideal moment to create collaboratives at the local level that can inform state and national policy if we are aware that we're in an ideological struggle, not necessarily a strictly research or evidence-based struggle. Say a little bit about Annenberg Institute. No, we do not have $500 million. The $500 million came from the Annenberg Challenge, and out of that $500 million, $50 million was used to establish the Annenberg Institute at Brown University in 1993. And as Sarah said, Ted Sizer, who was the founder of the Coalition of Essential Schools, was also the first founder of the Annenberg Institute. I arrived in 1998, having worked at the local level, state levels, and national levels in education reform, having learned many lessons, some of them very painful, and also never being able to say what Michael Jordan once said that was powerful, right? Michael Jordan, the basketball player, we are here in his home in Chicago, said, "In my life, I have failed time and time and time again. And that is why I succeed." So far, all I can say is in my life, I have failed time and time and time, time again. I hope to say, this time in particular, in collaboration with people like yourselves, that this time we are going to succeed, right? I say that because at the Annenberg Institute, we have three circles of work that reflect what I think are important levers that often go unnoticed. One is district redesign and leadership. Then for much of the era of school reform in my professional career, which began in 1980 and continues to exist, we talk about changing schools. We say little about changing the system that will either take school reform to scale or bury it under shifting priorities and policies and practices. So as you think about the kinds of schools you want to create, you also have to think about the kind of systems that have to be put in place to support that work, to refine it over time, and to take it to scale, and that's what we spend a lot of time thinking about. In Philadelphia, I learned a very painful lesson. I was pilloried by the community for a time around the issue of race, which I found shocking, right? I had black people in city government attacking me as a black leader of the Philadelphia Education Fund over something I said at a conference that was misinterpreted, right? And when I was asked to go before city council in Philadelphia by Chairman John Street to apologize for remarks that they knew I didn't say, as a compromise to end the whole issue, it's a long story. At the end of that, I was applauded by the black community, the white community for, you know, being very poised and very political. And I had a lunch with the dean of the city council, a woman, and I asked her, what happened here in Philadelphia? That I came here, I raised $60 million, I was doing standards-based reform, professional development. Why was I attacked, right? And why was I attacked on the issue of race around things that, you know, I didn't even say? And Gussie said to me, her name is Gussie Clark, she said to me, well, you know, Warren, you came to Philadelphia and you didn't ask permission to fish in our pond. I'm gonna repeat that, right? I raised $60 million, I was directing the Philadelphia Education Fund, I was working closely with the superintendent, working with the union, doing professional development, developing standards, and the leadership of the community says that I didn't ask permission to fish in their pond, right? And I said, well, you know, actually, I didn't think I was fishing in your pond, Gussie. I thought I was putting fish in the pond. You know, I got a little backbone sometimes, you know. I thought I was putting fish in the pond. And she said, you know, Warren, you're right, you were putting fish in the pond, but guess what? You didn't ask permission to put fish in the pond, right? That taught me an important lesson about the importance of community engagement, that when you approach your work as being primarily technical, right, that you only have to work with the technical people, the curriculum people, the research people. But I'd spent no time in Philadelphia understanding the community, its leadership, its culture, its social life. You know, I just worked, you know, 12-hour days and went home, went to bed, and on the weekends I just relaxed and went elsewhere. That I did not engage the community and allow them to know me and help them understand the work I was doing and to build ownership for it. And that's why, after learning that painful lesson, we have a circle of work at the Annenberg Institute called Community Organizing and Engagement. Because people like us, even though we are doing good work, that work has to be understood and owned by lots of people that we work on behalf of, that we rarely sometimes speak to or listen to or engage with. You know about the Annenberg Challenge. So one question is, how is it that a conservative Republican, right? Ambassador Annenberg was a conservative Republican, appointed by Ronald Reagan to be ambassador to Great Britain. He committed $500 million to public education, and that created the Urban Challenge, the Arts Challenge, and the Rural Challenge. And many of you, how many people of you were historically involved in Annenberg Challenge projects? Please raise your hand. my God, we're a dying breed. Look how old we look, right? But I bet you that much of the work that many of you do today who don't know about the challenge was actually rooted in the Annenberg Challenge, in the arts program, the rural program, and in the urban program. But we don't actually tell the story powerfully, and there's a good reason why. This man, a conservative Republican, gave his money to Vartan Gregorian at Brown University, who then allied himself with Vartan Gregorian, a noted liberal and progressive, to do a reform that was primarily bottom-up, created civic communities that organized themselves to do reform against three broad goals: improve education in inner-city schools, support achievement in rural schools, and demonstrate the power of the arts to enhance learning. That work was informed by these sets of design principles. All children can learn, rigorous standards and support, schools must engage parents as active partners, schools work better than ever. These were the design principles of the challenge that each community that received a grant organized and prioritized its work around. I would say very quickly that one of the things that the people on the right took from this was they were enraged that a bunch of liberals could capture a rich conservative billionaire and get him to give his money to do the things that they thought were important. And they vowed never to have that happen again. I'm serious about this, right? So when you think about the corporate philanthropies these days and who they seek their advice from, it's no longer the Ted Sizers or the Warren Simmonses or anybody that is considered too progressive or too liberal. Conservative think tanks have grown during this period of the 90s, and they capture their own philanthropists, like the Walton Foundation and others, and ensure that they are supporting ideologically correct, from their point of view, causes, right? And they've made a concerted effort over this period of time to get on the boards of traditionally progressive foundations like Ford and Rockefeller and Carnegie and make ideological corrections in their funding. So that was a powerful lesson that the conservative movement learned, and they took steps to correct what they call the liberal bias of philanthropy. One of the things that you need to be aware of is that operates locally as well, in your community foundations as well, and in your state foundations. Moving forward, here are some of the lessons from the Annenberg Challenge from the perspective of the people who supported this work. Let me tell you the conservative lessons of the Annenberg Challenge, as reported by the Fordham Institute. Money doesn't matter. Money in the hands of liberals leads to waste. And that money in the hands of reforms that don't focus on accountability and standards don't produce results, right? So you have these lessons that were produced by a group of researchers from, you know, liberal institutions like Harvard, Stanford, UCLA, Yale, Brown University, I'm leaving anybody out, Virginia Commonwealth. And you have the lessons that the growing numbers of conservatively oriented research think tanks produced to describe the Annenberg Challenge and to dissuade any other billionaire philanthropist with a conservative bent from investing in the kinds of work that people like you do in this room. And so we had the standards era. We had a nation at risk defining the problem of education as being a failure, and the purpose of education as primarily a tool to serve the economy. Now think about the fact that in 1983, when many of you were young, but I was just launching my career, we had a national report produced by business leaders that said schools were massive failures, right? And they were threatening to tank the economy. And the way to improve schools was to improve their ability to produce people who would serve the economy and be good for the workforce, right? That represented a major shift in the vision of education and in the definition of educational success. And we have been laboring under that shift in vision and definition ever since, either knowingly or unknowingly. Most of the standards movement in the 1990, which I participated in, accepted that vision and definition of education as a starting point, said other things are important, but largely said the purpose of schools is to serve and strengthen the economy and produce the kinds of workers that we need. We're seeing a gradual shift in the definition of success in the development of the Common Core, where we say now the purpose of schools is to what? To what? What? College and career readiness, right? Right. But think about, so what does college and career readiness mean, right? So now we have a Common Core where we say, well, we don't want to say directly it's about the economy, but it's about making sure that everybody's college and career ready. College and career ready for what? College and career ready so that after you get out of college, you what? You find a job. You know, so it basically, it's still heavily loaded with even the use of the term shifting from workforce preparation to college and career readiness. The definition of college and career readiness is still heavily defaulted in. When you get out of college, you better get a job. Otherwise, college hasn't been useful for you. So that's been the major thrust of the standards movement since 1990, when the national government began to take the architecture of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, which was designed to serve disadvantaged students, and use it to create the infrastructure for the standards movement. The development of national standards, which inform state standards, providing money to states to develop assessment systems, which were used to create accountability systems, which were used to describe schools as successes or failures, eventually accountability systems which were used to describe teachers as success and failures, students as successful failures, and communities as successes and failures, right? Do you see that sort of architecture that happened? And I was a part of that architecture because I believe, from an equity standpoint, that it was important to establish national standards so that all kids would be held to the same high expectations, and that the assessment systems would be used to focus on opportunity to learn, which was part of the original set of standards, which means you don't know what kinds of learning experiences kids should have unless you have a set of standards which specify what they should learn. Unfortunately, very early on, the opportunity to learn standards was dropped in favor of accountability systems. But we are at a moment in our history where schools are still failing, right? Even after a decade of redefinition and a decade of largely a conservative ideological framework on the problem, which I'll get to shortly. But these are the NAEP data since 2011 or so. And if we are engaged in anything called systemic reform, these results don't show it. States that go up, they go down, the achievement gap stays the same, it widens, it narrows by a grade level. There's just no consistent pattern here other than a pattern that says we're not doing so good. In the midst of decades of investment at the systemic level, creation of standards, accountability systems, we still have this pattern of poor results. And the solution, we say, is the development of a new round of standards, right? Well, those standards didn't work out so well, so we need a new round of standards, and that's the sort of Common Core. And again, this is developed by a good colleague of mine, Mike Cohen at Achieve, which is largely a business association of governors and business leaders. And I do say that the Common Core is an improvement on the other national standards. And here you see this new emphasis on communication, problem solving, critical thinking that you see in the new standards. But again, standards are important, but they require a delivery system to be realized, right? And so while we are applauding ourselves as a nation for developing yet another round of standards, which by the way, we're now using at the national level to develop what? What? I was only one person participating. This is a quiet class. We're developing, we've now got standards, so the most important thing for us to develop after we develop standards is what? Tests, right? That's an ideology, right? Let's just say that's an ideology. Right? The most important lever for us to focus on after we develop standards is?
Yes.
All right, but what other, are there other possible levers you might focus on if you develop standards? What? Name some.
Teachers.
What?
Teachers.
Teachers. You might invest in building the capacity of teachers. What a novel thought. Right? You might rush to put millions, billions of dollars into teacher capacity building. in districts. Anything else you might come up with if you were a raving liberal lunatic? What? Teachers, anything else? Curriculum, my God! Yeah, because the teachers have to be developed in relationship to what? Their ability to enact a curriculum. Oh, my goodness, you liberals. Right, you're gonna put money into teachers, and you're gonna put money into curriculum. What else? Fixing schools, supporting parents. Where do kids do most of their high-level learning and thinking? In the classroom? Oh, they do it outside of school, in family, home, and community settings, right? So maybe if you want kids to do this, you invest in creating learning opportunities that are relevant and aligned in the community, as well as investing in developing teachers, as well as investing in curriculum resources that can be used inside and outside. Any other raving, mad, lunatic ideas in this audience? Right. Pedagogy. There's what you teach, there's how you teach. Right, the way kids learn, right? Culturally responsive, sensitive, differentiated supports, right? We got students with disabilities, we have English language learners, we have students with achievement gaps, we have recent immigrants, right? We have lots of students whose needs need to be addressed in this. So far, nobody's mentioned teacher preparation institutions. Have you noticed that? Interesting. Want to notice that? What? Reduce class size. Actually, California did that a couple of years ago. But if you do that by itself without changing anything else, you don't do much, right?
Community arts education.
Why? And notice that's the last thing on the list so far. What kind of conference is this, right? I'm like, what? Outlandish. I don't know who would think of something like that. Arts education. Why arts education? And don't say it because it strengthens mathematics and science and will help people become good engineers. Don't tell me that. What?
It's fun.
Okay, I will say, yeah. Okay, see, there you go. You guys are mealy-mouthed about arts, right? And if you're mealy-mouthed about arts, then think about the rest of us, okay? So I'll tell you why I enjoyed the arts, right? They were another vehicle that I could use to understand my competence, right? I was sort of good in math, very good in English language arts. Then I got into the arts and it was another vehicle for me to understand my competence. It's another vehicle for me to use to communicate with the world and in fact become mainstream, more mainstream than I was growing up in East Harlem, Spanish Harlem at the time, being an African American from a welfare family, right? Suddenly I was in an orchestra and I was playing music that was mainstream and in places that were mainstream. We actually played in Carnegie Hall at one time, right? And so the arts gave me access to another vehicle to express myself, to learn my competence, to become part of a larger culture and society, to broaden my peer group, to broaden my network of adults, you know, people who were conductors and musicians, right? It gave me access to cultural venues and institutions in New York City that I wouldn't have thought about being engaged in had I not been involved in the arts, right? And let's just say this, was it fun? Huh? No, initially it wasn't fun. What's wrong with you people? Nothing that you're bad at initially is fun, right? Basketball wasn't fun for me when I first started playing basketball. Tennis wasn't fun for me when I first started playing tennis. It was something I did because I was compelled to become competent, and I saw adult role models that demonstrated to me its importance and value, which allowed me to continue to overcome the initial drudgery. You know what it was like for my family when I came home and practiced the viola? You know, for a couple of hours, right? What was it like for them? It was painful. It was painful for me, it was painful for them. What was it like coming through East Harlem with a viola case for me when I was like 10, 12 years old? What was that like? What? Scary. Yeah, the scary thing, right? But I persisted in that because I saw the ultimate value, right? So don't tell kids that doing things that initially are not fun or should be fun, right? They become fun as you learn to master, as you require self-discipline and competence and exposure over time. And kids, for instance, play basketball for long periods of time practicing drudgery tasks because they understand what it will lead to and it's valued in their communities, right? So we have to help them make that important connection with the arts, right? Now, we talked about the Common Core. We talked about the national rush to use a lever called assessments, which then become accountable. But you also said there are other levers to invest in. You said teacher professional development, right? You said curriculum. You said pedagogy. You said changing schools. You said investing in communities. And then somebody said arts, right? So those are your levers, right? Here's our federal government's levers, right? This is race to the top. $3.6 billion of your money and mine. Remember the levers you mentioned? These are the levers they're investing in. What are they read? I can't see over there. Read that for me.
Implement college and career ready standards.
Ha ha. I want to emphasize it's on the recruit and retain side, right? And less on the support. Go ahead, what's that? Of course. That was high priority. I heard it mentioned here several times. If you want to improve schools, build robust data systems. If you want to improve arts education, do what? Build robust data systems. All right. What's the last one there? All right. Here we go. Okay, the real problem in education reform is there are about 2,000 schools that are dragging us all down. You know where they are, right? You know where they are? Right? In inner cities, right? I always wonder about that term, inner city, right? What does that mean? It's where the brown and black people, I guess, I don't know what it means. Inner, poor people is where poor, but they call it inner, right? Inner, I don't know what that means. But neighborhoods with high concentrations of poverty, right? Let's just say that, because I know inner that means they're outer city. There are neighborhoods with high concentrations of poverty. This is where these schools are, right? What we are learning, because Race to the Top is now about 2 or 3 years old, is what are the results of Race to the Top going to look like in about a year? What are the results going to look like? Come on now.
Not much difference.
Not much difference, right? Not much difference, right? Because we're going to learn that putting a lot of Teach for America teachers in high schools with high concentrations of poverty where they served for 3 years probably didn't work. Flooding these schools with data without giving them support and what to do about that data, probably not going to do so much. Investing in teacher evaluation systems, it helps us evaluate them better, but doesn't help them or the people who are evaluating them figure out what to do about the results that they see. And developing more tests is just going to give us more test fatigue and going to create a backlash, right? And then maybe this isn't largely a performance management problem, right? Because in fact, the people who are leading the reform and defining the levers have corporate backgrounds, and they look at educational institutions in obvious ways. They see performance management problems all over the place. If we just evaluate people better, pay them better, you know, show them the data, right? Recruit them. Smart people, really smart people, not the kind of people we've been putting there, really smart people, right, who work hard, put them in those, then the problem will be solved, right? And if that doesn't solve the problem, we'll decentralize the systems, we'll charter schools, we'll do a bunch of things to take it out of the hands of the people who are now controlling education because they obviously can't do things. So it's created this new narrative that this is the problem. You saw the movie Waiting for Superman? That's the narrative. Right? The problem in education, ladies and gentlemen, that we need to solve is bad teachers. That's why you have teacher evaluation and compensation and Teach for America's major solutions, right? It's a teacher problem. So you get rid of most of them, get new people in there, evaluate them better, push them out, do whatever you want to do. Bad schools. Well, they are bad schools, right? But bad schools in the way it's described in this narrative is they're fixed by closing them down, by privatizing them and turning them over to alternate governance strategies. That's where you fix a bad school, right? Broken systems, let's turn them into portfolios where we do what? Rather than have a traditional central office run these schools because they're incompetent people because they came from those universities, just like the teachers, right? Sorry, I'm pointing you. I'm using you as a foil. I apologize for that. I got 1 minute. We'll just basically create portfolio systems where the job of the people in the central office are data people, right? They give data to schools and communities to show them how well they're doing, and they close them down when they're not doing so good, and they bring in outside providers and contractors to run the schools that aren't doing so good. That's the narrative, right? That narrative, if it stays in place, impels and compels a set of solutions to get us back to data systems, recruiting teachers, more standards, and more accountability. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want your solutions to be the primary ones that are used in urban education, suburban education across this country, you've got to come up with a new narrative. Right? What they are good at that we are miserable at, right, is they have a powerful communication engine in place that reinforces this narrative every single day through the Wall Street Journal, through op-ed articles in the New York Times. I mean, some of my Thomas Friedman's. I was over in Singapore with Wendy Kopp. Why is Wendy Kopp relevant to him being in Singapore, right? But in fact, it's a wonderful communication engine where their messages are relayed on a daily basis. If this is their narrative, and it leads to a set of strategies that are being used in a city near you right now. Chicago, New York City, Philadelphia, Detroit, New Orleans, mission accomplished, by the way. All the schools in New Orleans are good because they're all charter schools. Is that true? Well, I read about that all the time in the paper, right? New Orleans has been fixed, right? So what we realize, that's the portfolio strategy. Here's their solution. Give families good options and choices. Right? But what's a good option and a choice? Well, families will know it when they see it, right? What's the solution to building powerful schools? What's the solution? It's through autonomy. But if you give autonomy to those lousy principals and teachers who are there, does that work? No. Who are you giving autonomy to? To the new smart people you're putting in these schools, right? Right? Let the money follow the kid, which is to say, let them follow the kid wherever they are, even in private schools. A talent-seeking strategy. That sounds like a drone or something, right? But, yeah, it's like, there are smart people somewhere in this room. Right? I will have a sensor. You. Come with me. The rest of you, boom, right? that's called turnaround. Performance-based accountability, of course, right? If I just measure you against, you know, I tell you at the end of the year, you're not doing so good. You're horrible. You, great, right? Things will improve systemically, right? That's performance-based accountability. You get an apple, you get $1,000, you get $20,000, right? So what people are now saying loudly and clearly is that the failure to close the achievement gap is due to more than poor teaching and learning and lack of curriculum. It's also the broader social and economic factors at play. And that to change education and improve education at scale, we also have to address changes in communities. I'm going to stop shortly, all right? School and district reform models that pay little attention to political, social, and cultural dimensions of reform that reside inside and outside, they're going to fail. That's where community engagement becomes important. John DC was going to resign in LA the other day, and then he magically withdrew his resignation. Why? Because the community came out. Not because they liked him so much, but because they want some stability, for God's sakes, right? And Paul Vallis was kicked out of Bridgeport recently, he's a hero of the corporate reform model, because the community said, this guy, enough of this, right? Enough of this carpet-bagging reform. So community engagement is critical. And weak support for capacity building focused on the district level has to be addressed, right? But capacity building defined by our values and our vision of schools. I'm going to close with this. A lot of recent research. What we are now doing at the Annenberg Institute and lots of other organizations is realizing that we have to change the vision of education from schools designed to serve an economy and produce people educated to be participants in the workforce. Look, I want my son to be employed just like anybody else, right? But I also want broader things for him. One of the purposes of schools is to serve the ends of democracy. And the ends of democracy are both communal and individual, right? I want to participate in democracy so that it reflects my vision and values, as well as strengthening the broader community. I want an education system that helps everyone reach his or her own potential as they visualize it, not just as somebody in the Common Core visualizes what my potential is. Yeah, I want meaningful work, but I also want a system that prepares me for robust participation in civic life, which means I get to serve and inform democracy. Also, I don't know about you, but in my community, my education was a tool for not only my own development, but for the development of my family and my neighborhood and my community. And that's what I want my schools to do, not just be things that educate me so I can leave my community and leave my family and leave everybody behind struggling, but can reinvest and contribute to them. And schools have to develop a broader set of competencies and skills, academic, social, emotional, cultural, and political. That's where you are, it's people. Are important, right? And that the curriculum, teaching, and assessment should reflect these skills and competencies and promote deeper learning. Now, that's a different vision than the one we've been operating on and following since 1983 at A Nation at Risk. And a different vision from the one that has inspired Race to the Top, right? I'm not saying that vision is wrong. I'm saying that vision is too narrow, right? And it's formulated by a group of people who have a particular ideological bent. There's nothing wrong with a particular ideological bent as long as it's examined alongside of others. And I tell you, in those rooms that I've been in Washington, and I have been in those rooms, they're dominated by people with a particular ideological bent and language. They're not predisposed to allow other ideologies and languages and ways of seeing the world into the conversation. And so if that's how they play, and that is how they play, it's our job to make them play differently, right? And it's our job to make them play differently for the betterment of the lives of our children, our families, and our communities. But that requires us to be organized, ladies and gentlemen. And that requires us to be organized at the local level. Because this is a political, ideological battle, not simply a technical one. And what's happening in communities across the country now is the realization that we have to move away from the heroic performance management leader. You know, the Joel Kleins, the Michelle Rees, you know, those people who parachute in and save us for 3 years and then parachute out and form these billion-dollar organizations that are funded by who? 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 DOE in part, but no, Walton and Broad and those other deep-pocketed, you know, those guys leave the superintendency after a year or two, and they're running multi-billion dollar organizations suddenly, designed to do what? Communication and mobilizing to support their ideology. So we need to encounter that at the local level, talk about the need to build smart education systems, right? A smart education system goes well beyond the school and the school district. It incorporates what the Dallas Arts Partnership has done for years, by getting school resources, community resources, business resources, arts resources, organized and deployed in neighborhoods to support teachers, families, and students. It's what the Chicago Arts Learning Initiative is trying to do in some neighborhoods, right? And so, in essence, many people now understand that the solution is not simply forcing change on individual schools or even reorganizing districts, it's creating coalitions that mobilize people across sectors to build a common vision, align resources, and deploy those resources inside and outside of schools to support learning and development. Your job, I think, in order to change the narrative, is to clarify your vision, form partnerships with these collaboratives, and get this work done. I'd say that unions are now more willing to participate in this because they see the survival of education in this new vision is important to them. Grassroots organizers in the African American Latino communities in New York, the Coalition for Educational Justice, the Alliance for Quality Education, joining partnerships with unions. Higher education researchers are providing data to these kinds of local coalitions, the STRIVE partnerships that are led by Living Cities. So I think rather than continuing to operate in isolation, you all raised your hands and said you worked with schools, and many of you did. I'd say you probably work in a programmatic way. How do you also work in a systemic way where you are defining the vision, which defines what leadership should be doing, aligning resources, and also mobilizing ourselves to change the national narrative And therefore, the levers that people provide resources for to change schools and systems. The last thing I'm going to say, because they're starting to bring the hook out for me, is that means what I just said. I'm amazing that I can follow myself sometimes, right? Right. What's your vision, right? Arts is fun, I don't know, what's your vision? How do you vet your vision with allies in the community so that it's owned and shared and incorporates their vision as well, right? How do you develop a broader communication and engagement strategy so that your political power is enhanced because you have powerful allies to join forces with and to promote your work with, right? That's the work that we have to do, ladies and gentlemen. I'm excited that I might finally be able to say that I succeed, because the Annenberg Institute is supporting coalitions like this across the country and informing their work. And the powers that be are now being inundated in data, despite their ideology, it says it ain't working so well. So they're more open in this debate about the new direction for reform than they've been over the last 15 years. But their openness will only be a powerful lever if we speak powerfully to that brief moment in time when they are willing to listen. If we continue to be scattered, which progressives are very good at doing, and they continue to be focused, then their ideology will win, despite the fact that it isn't producing the results for children and family that we all want it to. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and I look forward to joining forces with you. Sit down. I'm going to go sit down. Am I going to sit down now?
So we have a moment to have a little conversation, and you have some index cards on your seats. So please go ahead and give us some provocative questions that you can talk with Warren about. While you're doing that, we'll have them passed to some of the guild staff so that they can kind of feed them up to us for discussion. And I think Warren would probably be pretty comfortable with some provocative questions so that
I'm done with provocation. Yeah.
What I find enchanting is that really the think tanks maybe aren't the place where the thinking is happening. And I think that and so, I mean, I have a number of questions just to perhaps start out is in terms of the kind of, we're a field that perhaps has a limited access to the overview of general education reform. Mm-hmm. We're working in arts education to make up for the absence of resources in our own communities, sometimes not always engaged in what's happening with these sort of ideological conversations. How do we participate in more of this kind of national conversation that recognizes the values of our community? So how do we realize this, especially when the vernacular of best practices, you know, we get these like, oh, this program, mm-hmm. This is the ideal arts program that links with the school district. Mm-hmm. So we all should mirror that. And so we also have this, on the national level, kind of like, should we be meeting up with these discussions of what's happening? You're kind of saying that, that some of these discussions aren't about serving the children and our communities. Like, how do we engage in this education reform conversation? There's so many histories. I mean, the charter school movement alone, you were saying market-based school reform, mm-hmm. but like the histories of those movements are very complex with a weaving of sometimes great art projects and sometimes not serving the arts at all and completely ignoring it.
Mm-hmm. Well, what's your question? No, I'm sorry.
I was just so excited. I'm sorry.
There's several yeah. questions in there, but I'll answer one at least. I find that it is difficult to engage in a conversation that opens ideology at the national level, because at the national level, there's such a tight-knit group of organizations and associations that have the same ideological drumbeat, right? I know the organizations they're going to have in the room, the Fordham Foundation, the Center for American Progress, about Education Trust, Heritage Foundation, right?
Yeah.
Council of Chief State School Officers, right? So they are a tight-knit group. They've worked together for 20 years, and they have arrived at this place together, right? On the other hand, there is much more ideological openness at the local level, particularly in urban communities, right? If you show up at that national meeting, I'm invited to those meetings, but I'm usually the only one in the room, right? Well, Warren, what do you think? I said, oh, thank you. Right? And they go back, right? Right? So if you're always there as the one person in the room that's sort of, you know, not marching to the beat of everybody else's drum, it's easy to ignore. If we organize ourselves in community collaboratives locally that represent business, civic leadership, arts community, cultural communities, grassroots communities, teacher unions, it's much harder for them to ignore our evidence, our vision, our values, and our results, right? So my recommendation to you is, you might want to get in that conversation to the extent that you can, just to understand what it is they're saying and how they're thinking, but then take that back to your local collaboratives and coalitions and use that to get your mayor, your city council, your union leadership, your community leadership organized to present a counter narrative and a counter proposal. I would say that what we're trying to do at Annenberg is form alliances across various urban communities, Chicago, New York City, LA, Atlanta, New Orleans, to operate in unison even as they have different concerns. But as mayors change, as superintendents change, communities remain the same, and it's their vision that needs to be articulated and fed up, as opposed to what we now have is a vision created up here that's fed down that we respond to.
Okay, so we have some questions.
I answered one of your questions.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. I think my other question as a philosopher is, what is a system? Maybe I'll hold that.
Right.
here's one of the questions from the audience. Mm-hmm. Is it possible to describe an example of a district or region that has achieved system reform that you're talking about? If they have made an impact on national policy?
So actually, follow the winners of the Broad Prize. You ever watch, the Broad Foundation? Right? Yeah. They're one of the most powerful and consistent purveyors of the performance management approach. They actually train most of the superintendents who come to run a city near you. But the districts that they give awards to, remarkably, don't follow their practices, right? And then nobody seems to see the contradiction. Right? They do this whole portfolio thing, performance management thing. Then they give the Broad Prize to somebody like Hillsborough, Florida, Long Beach, right? These are districts where, first of all, they've had superintendents, very traditional superintendents, in place for a decade or more. The district works with the higher education community closely, the arts community closely, civic leadership and community leadership closely, and they focus on curriculum and instruction, school change in school and outside of school, right? Very unlike the models that Broad espouses nationally and trains superintendents. But so there are districts, Virginia Beach, for God's sakes, that won the Broad Prize repeatedly. And no one seems to say to the people at Broad and to the Walton Foundation, well, the people that win the Broad Prize actually don't follow your ideological path and the levers that you say we should be using. You know, as they would say in my neighborhood, how come that is, right? So there are examples, and furthermore, I'd say Boston is also an example. My college in New England, but Boston and the state of Massachusetts are examples of places that invest in teacher networks, school networks, curriculum and instruction, and increasingly partnerships with communities. That's not what you saw in Race to the Top as the model, and yet their results lead the country and the nation, both at the state level and in urban communities.
And that's why they have such good baseball players, right?
In
Boston.
As a lifelong Yankee fan, I do not appreciate that remark. It reflects an ideological bent I have no use for.
So just to let everybody know, we're going to run a little longer till 11:55. That should give you plenty of time for the rest of the morning, but we just wanted to be able to continue this conversation. Another question, Warren. If you were the Secretary of Education, what are the first...
I should have been the Secretary of Education, by the way.
What are...
Sorry. It's not being videotaped, is it? Arnie, I love you, Arnie. I love you.
What are the first two things you would do? Because being in the political positions creates certain constraints. And... Would that frame what you would be able to do?
So actually, you know, at Annenberg, we created something called the Alliance for Smart Schools, Systems, and Communities, a loose confederation of the NAACP, the Urban League, NEA, American Federation of Teachers, and lots of like-minded, equity-minded organizations.
National Education Association,
not the National Endowment for the Arts, right? We came together to develop a new vision statement, which you saw there, and a new set of design principles, which were on a slide that didn't make it, apparently. When the department got wind of that, they invited us to meet with them. So they invited myself, Randy Weingarten, Pedro Noguera, and somebody from the National Council, La Raza. So our recommendation to Arnie was this, because this is what I would do if I was education secretary. He said, you know, all this performance management stuff is necessary, but grossly insufficient. What the Department of Education needs to do is invest in capacity building, right? Which is basically everything you said were your first level of priorities, right? That's what I meant by capacity building. Professional development for teachers, curriculum resources, investments in schools, investments in learning opportunities outside of school, right? His first response to that was, and this shows his ideological bent, you mean we're gonna recreate those old dysfunctional central offices? Right? That's an ideological bent, right? The man was CEO here in Chicago. He never got control of his own central office, right? So therefore, there are things that are uncontrollable that need to be eliminated or obliterated from the earth, right? And I said, well, no, it doesn't have to be a traditional approach to capacity building. You can actually develop consortia of private, I knew enough to throw the word private in there, private and public institutions that could be organized and funded through performance accountability measures to perform certain functions like professional development, curriculum, blah, blah, blah. He said arts education. I wasn't too bold at that time. Right? I was going to get you guys in there after I got the money. Right? He said that's a great idea. What did he say? What did somebody say? Get that person out of the room. He said, great idea, right? I can think about using Title II monies to do capacity building. Right? I haven't heard from Arnie since, right? But in essence, did you see the first reaction was he responded to the idea of capacity building was through his ideological lens of broken system, right? If you tell him and people like him that the system should build capacity since they are anti-system people, right? It's like anti-government. If you say government should do this to people who don't believe the government has the ability to do anything, it just creates cognitive dissonance, right? So you have to, number one, understand that ideological bias. They're anti-government, anti-system people, right? And they have a lot of evidence for that belief, by the way, right? Which we've provided to them, right? But instead of saying, how do we fix government and fix systems, their thing is to break it down, to privatize it. What you have to do is give them a model for actually how you could build a new system that incorporates some of their, and anticipates some of their antipathy to having it controlled by the existing system, which has proven itself to be pretty dysfunctional, right? Mm-hmm. So if you do talk about consortia, public-private partnerships, but emphasize the functions and work on the delivery system mechanisms at some later time, you have a better chance to be heard and to be acted upon, because they do understand. I've heard it in charter networks, by the way. 3 or 4 years ago, the charter people said, all we need is these smart people from Brown, Harvard, Yale, and Virginia Commonwealth, right? In these schools, we can work them hard, get rid of them, replace them, and things will be fine. The test results are now showing that they're not producing what they thought they were, and now they're saying, we need systems. We need what?
Systems.
What are they saying they need? Professional development, curriculum development, and they are saying arts education and partnership with community, which they did not say 3 or 4 years ago. You're afraid to ask me another question because this could take 15-minute answers.
It's good. So when you're talking about systems, I mean, in some ways, we're good at building systems because it's hard for us because we inherit things we've done in the past, and it's kind of, you know, not changed that much.
Who's good at building systems?
Well, I guess education leaders.
Ladies and gentlemen, we live in a country that has a history, at least in the last 30, 40 years, of failing to execute systems, right? Look at the Acela Express for those of you who live on the East Coast, right? Look at Europe. They managed to have a system of high-speed rail. What we have is a high-speed train that operates on low-speed rail, right? Because of our governance system doesn't allow us to plan and act across state and local jurisdiction lines. Look at our health attempts to create a healthcare system. We can't execute a website, right? What we have, in fact, is we have a governance structure that preserves local control over our democracy and served us well for years. It just doesn't serve our ability to create and execute systems in the same way that national governments do. Mm-hmm. So in education, think about this. We are trying to have national standards and achieve national results that we have to negotiate with 50 different states and 15,000 districts and 144,000 separate schools that are getting even more differentiated because some of them are traditional and charter, right? So that's the system that we are trying to deliver common results, common standards across. It's very cumbersome. And in fact, when I talk to my colleagues in the UK, in fact, I didn't mention higher ed, right? Higher ed, we have a teacher preparation system that doesn't have to pay any attention to the districts that it serves or the national standards. None whatsoever. Now, you ask me, why do I say that? Did you ask me that question?
Why do you say that?
I said that because I had the novel idea when I was in Philadelphia. We developed local standards in Philadelphia. Interesting thing happens when you develop local standards. When we develop standards locally, what discipline area suddenly rose to importance to be one that should have its own standards? What? The arts! Somebody said science over here. Right, the arts, right? So you develop standards locally. Some local communities say, we value the arts, we want art standards. Boom, we had art standards, we had math standards, literature standards, right? I, being a naive person, said, ooh, what college and university provides us with 48% of our new teachers in Philadelphia every year? Temple University, right? So, brilliant person that I am, I go to the dean, who I knew, Temple, said, here are the district standards. You provide us with 48% of our new teachers every year, do you think you might be able to incorporate these standards in your teacher preparation curriculum? And his answer was?
No.
No, his answer was, that's a brilliant idea. He took it to the faculty. Their answer was? No. Right? The fact that you cannot harness, most K-12 institutions cannot harness the higher education institution in their local area that produces most of their new teachers means we have a flawed system. Unlike European countries where they develop national standards, they can get the higher ed, teacher preparation, K-12, everybody aligned and working off that.
So if we're able to improve the system, it's not the current status purports to have more freedom and flexibility because of local control.
Right.
But what you're saying is that if we're able to shape the kinds of systems you're suggesting, smart education systems, we actually would have more freedom and flexibility to do more with our schools and our children, our communities.
I'd say this. The vulnerability of our current system, because it's so fragmented and loosely coupled, is that it is highly susceptible to ideological takeover. Right? And we'll repeat this. When you're that fragmented and disconnected, arts people don't talk to math people, don't talk to English language arts people, who don't talk to the African American community, don't talk to the Latino community, who doesn't talk to each other. Superintendents come and go. Chief state school officers, you got a new mayor every 4 or 5 years. That's a very fragmented system. In its fragmentation, it's working off of multiple purposes. It is highly vulnerable to ideological takeover, right? One group that's poised and focused can insert itself in a group of fragmented, scattered people who are isolated and mostly at war with each other or in conflict with each other, right? So that's the system that we have. And that's why you can have a couple of people in Washington basically using 3.6. Anybody ask you that you want to use your tax dollars to do that? No, it was announced. I was in a room when it was plotted. It was about 20 people in that room, right? And me saying, well, well. So to counter that, we have to transform ourselves through our current system of loosely coupled relationships, all of us doing our own thing, right, to one that is more organized, aligned around a common vision. Given our tradition and given the current political apparatus, it's more easy for us, did I say more easy? It's easier for us to do that at the local level, right? And then work our way up. But that's the system we have, and our democratic institutions operate that way. It is a barrier to systemic change, but it does protect and privilege local control at the expense of being susceptible to external takeover.
Thank you. So maybe we can talk a little bit more about our local communities. And someone has a question about specifically a place like Chicago, which is tied to economic development. Mm-hmm. And you may be aware, in the arts community, we have this discussion about creative cities, creative
right.
placemaking,
yeah.
and the creative class.
Yeah.
Assuming that there's a not creative
class. I read it
class,
in your beautiful paper,
which
by
is...
the way. It's a wonderful paper. I read that on the plane ride here.
Ah, thank you. I wrote a paper called The Mute Child in the Creative City. Mm-hmm. But someone asks about the economic development of the
city. Did you write that card yourself?
No.
Okay.
I didn't. Someone asks, in systems like Chicago, mm-hmm. which are tied to the economic development plan for the city, and that plan is often based on gentrification, how do we organize against that?
So I'm saying that because actually the Annenberg Institute was in Chicago 6 years ago when Arnie was the CEO, and we led an effort called the Mid-South. Anybody remember that effort? Huh? Okay, here was the Mid-South. It actually was an effort to do what you just described, right? We were brought in by a donors group, MacArthur Foundation, Joyce Foundation, Chicago Community Trust, right? Basically, they wanted us to lead a planning process that involved the Department of Housing and Economic Development, business group, the school district, and grassroots organizing and political leadership in an area of the South Side called Bronzeville, which actually crossed three wards, right? Why did they bring in the Annenberg Institute? Because they have a brilliant leader, Warren Simmons. But we also were seen as a neutral entity. Right? Each of the other entities had their perceived biases, right? I had to be vetted by the mayor, then Mayor Daley, the son of the other Daley, right? Once he approved, we started working. Arnie was the CEO, right? One of the first things we encountered when we organized the grassroots was a suspicion that this was all about gentrification and serving the University of Chicago and pushing the black and brown people who were there out and creating schools and resources that would serve the majority community, right? And we worked very hard to overcome that. We had charrettes and planning and focus group meeting. We had to pull the central office in, the housing department, because people in Chicago actually weren't accustomed to working in a collaborative way. Pray tell, right? It's because of the deep distrust around racial, class, economic, neighborhood lines here. We actually created a wonderful preliminary plan in 3 months. And then the district made a very bad move and the city made a bad move. They turned the implementation over to a firm downtown, right, to lead the implementation process. Now, when you turn the thing over from Annenberg to a firm downtown Chicago, what signal does that send about who's going to be in charge? Huh? Why are you so quiet? Is it who? White folks. But I'll be more specific. What? Rich white folks, businessmen. Right? Y'all ain't all rich, although you think us think you are. But rich business leaders, right? Right? Horrible move. But when you're blinded by your ideological lens, you do things and you not. And then the first thing they did around the regentrification was announce school closings, right? Not what you're going to invest in, not what you're going to build, but what you're going to close, right? Those two moves alone sank the Mid-South process, even as other neighborhoods, the West Side in particular, said, we want that process here, right? So I would say many neighborhoods and communities around the country understanding this need for organizing collaboration. What we lack are organizations that have the credibility to facilitate, in a value-centered way, where your values are on the table, and trust that the implementation is going to reflect those values and not being taken over by one group or another that has power and privilege and status. So I think what I'm seeing in the Strive partnerships that are organized by Living Cities, and what I see in the Promised Neighborhood work that was inspired by the Harlem Children's Zone, that's a more community-centered model for planning and development than one that often starts with elites that then who try to reach out to communities who perceive that they're manipulating them more than they are engaging them.
So thank you. That's very helpful, I think, because of so many of our organizations are on the interface between the community, the school, and different other organizations. And I want to ask this question about, someone asked about teachers. So let's talk for a second about teachers. And I think that the arts education community delivers an unusual teaching workforce. We work with teaching artists. We work with artists in engaging them in our work. We work with actual teachers. We work with leaders and superintendents and principals. Mm-hmm. So we sort of try to speak many languages. Mm-hmm. One of our audience members asks, any teacher I know in the public school system knows what is wrong with the current educational environment. Why are their voices not being heard?
So one reason is the traditional vehicle for voicing the concerns of teachers has been there. Union, right? Their union leaders felt besieged. They are also, for the most part, old school people, trained in the old school ways of thinking and acting, which means being in an adversarial relationship, not only with district leadership, but also with community leadership, right? I think the leadership of both the AFT at the national level and the NEA, National Education Association, understands that they have to fundamentally shift their stance from an adversarial relationship with community to a constructive dialogue with community and empower their teachers to be engaged in an essential part of that dialogue, because they've been very authoritarian and dictatorial as an institution and organization, right? Because you basically, their unions have mirrored in their own minds the institutions that they have to deal with. A hierarchical, dictatorial, authoritarian district creates a hierarchical, dictatorial teachers union to respond to. So both sides have to fundamentally change their cultures. They are hard at work at that. In fact, I just came from a meeting in LA, which was a national meeting entitled Reclaiming the Promise, which brought in community advocates and organizers and union leaders and teams from at least 20 cities around the country to talk about creating a shared dialogue organized by a common set of principles. The principles are on the website of the AFT and the Schott Foundation. They're called the Unity Design Principles. So there is a move afoot supported by the AFT to begin or strengthen this dialogue between union leadership and community leadership to basically create a shared stance as the new superintendents and new mayors come on board and ask the question, what's the new direction and next step that we should be taking in school reform? I think it's promising, but it's only going to succeed if the grassroots, both on the teacher side and the community side, make it an accountable and an authentic conversation and don't rely on the leadership, who may be driven by old values and cultures, to lead the day.
So I'm going to ask one more question.
You told me that was your last question.
We have a few minutes.
Oh, we do? I haven't been talking enough.
Yeah, I'll ask one more question. And then just to note that we'll have a session at 2 o'clock. So those of you who want to join us, please come to that session about the design.
That could be a principles. Referendum on this presentation. Like 10 people show up at the session at 2 o'clock.
So you've given us lots of examples. And in arts education, you know, sometimes, and even when you were talking about if you were education secretary, maybe arts education would come in after the discussion. And I think, like, we are eager to understand, you know, how do we both advocate for our field and our work when we can see it as such such a valuable part of educating a young child and part of a democratic conversation? How do we not come off as interlopers when we're trying to get into these conversations, when we're not not invited, but we feel like we have lots of resources. We can even articulate it in a research-framed manner through organizations like this, the National Guild. So, but we often kind of come off as sort of interlopers in those conversations.
So I would say, it's not so much that you come off as interlopers. Sometimes you actually come off as elitists. I will repeat this. I don't want you charging up at me. This is an open dialogue, right? You come off as elitist. That is to say that many of these communities have their own rich arts traditions, but when you talk about arts, you don't talk about those traditions. You talk about traditional art forms and genres, right? So for example, I'm working in New York City with a guy named Adrian Robinson who works for Belafonte Enterprises, right? And Harry Belafonte in New York City has been a supporter of Mayor, well, he hasn't been elected yet, but he's a Democratic nominee for mayor, which in New York means he's gonna be the next mayor, y'all. I can be so sophisticated sometimes, right? Mayor de Blasio. But the arts community that Harry Belafonte is assembling includes people like Rosario Dawson, Jay-Z. It's a different kind of arts community than we traditionally think about. It's an arts community that the people in Harlem and Brooklyn, who are black and brown, and they sort of recognize and understand. And so I think when we talk about arts community, we have to be more open and embracing than we perhaps have appeared to be in the past when we talk about arts community. What Belafonte realizes is his ability to be articulate and a player in educational reform in New York City and nationally is dependent upon him forming alliances with organizations like mine, who have credibility on the education side, but don't know much about the art side, nor have the political social capital to get Jay-Z or Jamie Foxx or Rosario Dawson or Chaka Khan or Prince to show up at anything. I'd like to get them to show up or something, but I don't have that kind of relationship. And so that's the number one, making sure that your notion of the arts is broad and inclusive, right? Number two, that you as arts educators have a certain level of expertise, but you don't have all the expertise, nor do you have all the political social capital that you need. So you need to form a broader partnership where your expertise and values are represented under a larger umbrella to enhance your power and voice and visibility. And unions are part of that. The other thing is to be mindful of where you can insert yourself in current opportunities, right? The community schools movement. Most people say they're doing community schools, right? Now, what could that be? That could be almost anything, right? But the arts has a place in the community schools movement as long as you make sure that the arts has a place in the community schools movement. Lots of districts are doing extended learning time. Chicago, New York, people are calling for extended learning time. We could use that time to do more testing, more data analysis and collection, right? Or whatever, you want to do more performance management, or we can use that time for enrichment activities in the arts and other areas, right? And so as these terms and education reform strategies become popular, community schools, extended learning, extended day, extended year, promised neighborhoods, you have to ensure that the arts is part of that definition, as opposed to waiting for the arts to be included in that definition. You have to make it so.
All right.
Wait. I'm going to try this one on you. Or as Yoda said, do or do not, but do not try.
Well, that leaves us with a lot of work to do, I think. Thank you so much, Warren.
Thank you.